And let's get more reactions to the appointment of Yulo Loizaga to the Environment Department. Joining us now, Heidi Fernandez. She's executive director of the Save Zambales Kalikasan Movement. We're also joined by Leon Dulce, national coordinator of the Kalikasan People's Network for the Environment. Guys, good afternoon to you both, and thank you for joining us today.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Hi, welcome to the program. Okay, I'm going to start with Leon first. Let's lay the foundation here. What to you is the true state of the environment as we speak, Leon?
So we're going into the new administration with a clear global consensus that we have less than a decade left for decisive action to address the runaway climate crisis. But it's not only the climate crisis, you have multiple planetary crises. We already have experience with the pandemic that we know is zoonotic in nature, which means it comes from the disruption of nature as well. We know that we are approaching the sixth mass extinction event of biodiversity loss. So there are multiple crises where the Environment Department's leadership will be crucial if we are going to rise above these challenges. So definitely the upcoming Environment Secretary has her hands full in terms of ensuring the non-negotiables on environment and climate justice, especially at a time when there will be definitely competing interests.
Leon, you know, in a statement, she said that she hopes to get multi-sectoral support in achieving resilient and sustainable development of the environment. But let me go to you, Heidi, for this question. I mean, we know that that's what's happening globally, but here in the Philippines, you know, you have environment protection in some areas, but you also have cases in some areas where the DENR, it seems, at least in the past administration, to be complicit in the destruction of resources and biodiversity and the ecosystem in some areas, Heidi.
Yes. We also have problems on the ground here, because I'm here now in Central Luzon and Zambales. No? In the past regime of the DENR, under the Duterte administration, we have experienced a lot of violations from the agency itself, the DNR. Like they have projects that are actually very critical to the environment. Like here in Zambales, in our town, they wanted to build a jetty port for mining to transport and import lahar to China and the Singapore without any people's consultations and the proper permits, the pertinent permits. And we were able to fight that through protests and through people's actions. Mm-hmm. And a lot of complaints and letters and correspondence with the officials of the DNR. And we also held a 29-day campaign beside the river to protect our river from being converted into a road for the jetty port.
Mm-mm. And as I understand, Heidi, this is not exclusive to Zambales. There are other areas as well where certificates indeed have been granted when they shouldn't have been granted to begin with. So what are your expectations from the incoming Environment Secretary? We know that the advocacy is there. We know that it's going to be science-backed, whatever policies she may have, at least that is the expectation. But in terms of this specific problem, Heidi, what are your expectations from the incoming secretary or the newly nominated secretary? Go ahead, Heidi.
Well, we're happy that she was nominated, and we hope that she will be our new DNR secretary because of her background in climate change, climate mitigating projects and programs. And of course, she was former Manila Observatory chief, and Manila Observatory is our partner in our advocacy for environmental protection here in the province and in the Philippines. So we're happy. We expect that you will come out with better solutions to these problems, bureaucratic problems, and these issues of being some organizations issued ECCs, which should not have been issued in the first place. And of course, due process, like people's consultations before any project takes place on the ground.
Let me go to Leon for his expectations. What are your expectations for the newly nominated secretary, Leon?
well, we have already discussed her civil society background, but she also has two other backgrounds that we should consider. Number one, she is a cousin of the First Lady, and therefore there could be some family interests that can, you know, obstruct the integrity of our environmental governance in the DENR. And then number two, she also has a background in working with businesses, especially big businesses, through the National Resilience Council, which is a foundation that is mainly has its membership of from the private sector. So I think I understand why pro-mining groups are also welcoming her entry into the DENR, because she has that business background as well. So we hope that the imperatives of science and the imperatives of social justice will be the primary thrust of this new governance in the DENR. The test case would be the different projects, the destructive and extractive projects that Heidi mentioned as well, no? But also other more enormous projects like the Kaliwa Dam or the Pasig River Expressway, and the various other mines in Romblon, in Palawan, in Nueva Vizcaya, in Tampakan, South Cotabato. There are a lot of projects that have go signals, have been given various levels of permit. So we are calling on the new DENR secretary to impose an omnibus moratorium on these destructive projects until such time that these projects have been scientifically reviewed and have been consulted on the people.
Leon, let me just go back to a point that you were making earlier. Are you concerned that while there is optimism, because there is or there might be partnership, a stronger partnership between the public and the private sector with the newly nominated secretary, are you concerned that this kind of a partnership might just lead to compromises, to the disadvantage of the Filipino people? Leon.
Indeed, diplomacy always entails, you know, compromise. So trying to facilitate cooperation between business and frontline communities will always be a challenge. You know? So it's going to be a tightrope that Secretary Tony will be walking. And we hope that she puts an emphasis on, you know, applying her Ignatian values from the Ateneo in really listening to the cry of the poor, really listening to land and environmental defenders such as us, because we know what is the real deal happening on the ground, as opposed to what the business groups or what the proponents of the projects will most likely be projecting. No? So we hope for an open line and an honest line with environmental defenders on the ground with the incoming environment secretary.
And talking about that particular situation, I mean, Heidi is here. She knows the experience here, that on the ground, it's not just about the wicked weather or, you know, putting up something to benefit the public. It's more than that. It's the business, or it's the presence of politics in preserving the environment, in preserving ecosystems. Tell us more about your experience, and Heidi, and what do you think should be done so that these kinds of situations will not be replicated, or at least will be put to a stop with the new secretary now at the helm, Heidi?
Oh, the only thing that should be done is just to follow the laws, because we have all the environmental laws present, that if we follow the laws, we will be able to protect our environment. The thing is, it is the people who are implementing the laws who are also violating the laws, like the issuance of ECC. They're not properly issuing ECCs to the proper project. And they're actually letting people and some businesses continue with mining and other extractive industries and other destructive environmental activities or critical environmental activities without the pertinent permits, without science studies or the environmental impact studies. That's the main problem in the DNR right now. Mm. So if they will just implement the law, we will be able to protect our environment.
You know, Leon, when you talk about defending, protecting the environment, violence to some people should be out of the equation. But really, when you talk about what is happening on the ground, violence has become a part of it. You talk about land defenders, right? You talk about people putting their lives on the line to defend the ecosystem, the environment. Tell us more about that. And tell us what the newly nominated Secretary Yulo Loizaga is really going to face and will have to be prepared to do to put a stop to these activities. Leon.
So the Philippines has actually been declared as one of the world's deadliest countries for land and environmental defenders over the past 8 years. Actually, over the past 8 years, Asia's deadliest country in the region. No? And this is because there is a culture of impunity perpetuated by the situation where, yes, we have some good environmental laws, but we also have some bad natural resource laws that offset these laws. And when government executes or implements, they focus more on the economic and natural resource laws, such as the Mining Act of 1995 and the Forest Code and the Fisheries Code. So the tendency from policy to actual governance is to focus more on extractivism, is to focus more on giving more incentives and opening it up more to big businesses. So that will be one of the main challenges where you have a full-on a deluge of big business projects, and usually to the detriment of people's rights on the ground. The government also has an investment defense policy framework where they even resort to the use of the armed forces of the state to enforce their critical projects, their flagship projects, such as build, mining, and all those kinds of extractive, destructive projects. So that results into a very violent situation where, you know, even established protected areas like the Masungi Geo Reserve are facing dangers because of encroaching land grabbing and other conflicting land use projects in the supposedly protected area. So this is the dangerous situation that we are all facing as of the present.
But, you know, she is going to be quite far away from what is happening on the ground. Both of you know that really the battle is there on the ground and the LGUs that are involved. What do you think her leadership brings into the picture now that wasn't present there during past administrations that would make these LGUs follow her lead, be accountable, and really put everything on track? I'm going to start with Heidi first, and then I'm going to go to Leon. Heidi, you go first.
Well, I think her years of and decades of experience with civil society organizations and climate change, her knowledge on that area, I think she'll bring in a lot of inputs, a lot of better leadership when it comes to that, because the bottom line here is to protect the environment. And how to protect the environment best is when you consult the people. That's the key, people's consultations. And that's what the government has not been doing. You know, it's not only the DNR, but it includes other agencies like the DPWH. In fact, we're battling another project here that's also very, very inimical to our environment here. The Zambales Coastal Road. They're building a road along the coast, and this is destroying our tourism. This is destroying the habitat of our turtles, our sea turtles, which are already very threatened. So our environment in the Philippines is so very threatened. It's not only here in Central Luzon, it's not only here in Luzon, but Visayas and Mindanao. This is our experience. So we hope that she would bring in the true essence of people's consultations. And it's not the artificial consultations with big business that are trying to implement projects that are critical to the environment. Hmm. And the priority should be people's consultations and people's rights in protecting the environment. So I guess, yeah, what Leon said a while ago about social justice and all that, and even in the mining industry, it should always be, the key is people's consultations and real people's consultations.
Leon, let me just go back to a point that you were making earlier. This is one of the concerns that you raised, that she is known to be a cousin of First Lady Elisa Araneta Marcos. What to you must she do, or what are you going to watch out for that will really show that she is truly independent from her ties to the palace?
I think it would be for the incoming secretary to really stick to her expertise. Because if we stick to the scientific basis, if we stick to the frameworks on disaster risk reduction, where we understand that people are the biggest factor in the risk, if you address the threats that are posed to communities, physical, socio-economic as well, organizational, then you are able to ensure not only the lives and welfare and rights of people, but also the economy, the socio-economy that they constitute. No? So actually investing in climate resilience as a framework will give us net gains in our economy in terms of what we save from disasters and environment and climate conservation and protection. So I think if the incoming secretary is able to ensure that that family does not come first, if she is able to ensure that we stick to the science and we apply it to the realities on the ground, then we will have an indicator that we are following through with the big promise, the grand promise of the Marcos presidency, that climate change will be one of their priority policies and concerns in their administration.
Leon Dulce there, National Coordinator of Kalikasan People's Network for the Environment, and of course Heidi Fernandez, Executive Director of Save Zambales Kalikasan Movement. Appreciate you both joining me today on the program. Thanks again. Take care and keep safe, guys.
Thank you.